Good morning. Welcome. It's a privilege, a joy to welcome you. Beautiful Sunday morning, beautiful day to be together to worship. Welcome each of you this morning. Welcome those of you that are joining us online. Glad to have you part of our extended family here today. It is a great day to worship. We're starting a new series this week called Thanks and Giving, and we'll talk more about that at that time during the worship service. Let me remind you a few things about this service. One, and I see most of them have already made it down, but if you have an attendance pad at your feet, if you're sitting at the end of an aisle, if you take that and pass that down, and as those are going, or if they've already gone down, you can grab it. But I want to remind you that next Sunday, after this service, we'll be having our new member and information luncheon, Pizza with the Pastor. If you're interested in being a part of that, that's for those who are interested in joining the church, or if you just want to learn a little bit more about us, you're invited to come. The luncheon is in the fellowship hall, which is the education building to my left, to your right. So I'm referencing those pads because as they go down, if you're going to attend that, please, even if you've done this in the weeks past, check that box that says wish to join the church. That's just a way of letting us know you're interested in attending so that we have enough food for everybody. That's basically what's the most important thing, because if I run out of food, you all are going to be mad. So that's next week. The other thing, let me say, if you have previously attended a new member luncheon and weren't able to join at that time but are going to join this time, please call the church. Make sure we have your information and make sure we know. Because if you don't, then I'm not going to know, and we're going to be very awkward on New Member Sunday. So please call and double check to make sure we have that information and we know that you plan to join the church. So that's just one of those things that's coming up. Let me remind you a few other things about worship this morning. We do celebrate communion. So if you would like to share that sacrament with us, then hopefully you picked up a communion packet when you came in today. If you didn't, don't worry about it. You can get them while we're singing at near any of the doors, or we'll bring them back around at that time of the service. And always remind you, we have gluten-free elements here on the table to your right and to my left. We also have offering boxes around the room for our offering this morning, for prayer cards. If there's anything we can be in prayer with you or for you, please fill out one of those prayer cards, drop those in. And if you are a guest and here for the first time, we'd love to learn a little bit about you. There are guest information cards, and you can share with us and drop those things in as well. So all of those pertain to worship. Parents, we'll dismiss the kids for their children's ministry time after our opening song set. So if you want your kids to go and be a part of that, make sure you've signed them in the gathering place. And the last thing, I haven't announced this in a long time, especially if you're new. You may not know parents, caregivers. That's a Freudian slip. We have a comfort room down the hall where the nursery is, just to my left. Right back, you can go through these doors or through the back. If you ever need some privacy, if you need to sit with your children, that's a room, and we've got the closed circuit TV in there. So that's just there if you need it. And so I always want to kind of make you aware of some of the unique parts of our facility. Now, let me highlight a couple quick announcements. Some we're going to get to during the prayer time, but I do want to lift up our thrift stores this morning and let you know that we are in need, as we always are, of volunteers. With that, we have so many folks that work so hard, many of you that are volunteers. It's a vital ministry in supporting the mission of the church. If you're able to donate a few hours a week, especially in the donation shed, it makes a huge difference. So, and as we head into the season, if that's something you're able to do, there's a sign-up sheet on the welcome desk in the gathering place, or you can call the church office or the thrift stores and let them know so we can make note of your interest in being a part of that ministry team. So I want you to be aware of that. Also coming up in a little over a week, November 16th and 17th, let me back up, the next food distribution pantry Saturday is going to be our annual Thanksgiving basket giveaway, in which case we give frozen turkeys to the families that come through. Now, to give you a little bit of an insight, yesterday, Jimmy was sharing with me about 220 cars came through our food pantry, representing 250 families, over 1,000 adults and children that were served. So this one coming up is going to be even bigger. So if you are able, on November 16th and November 17th, we're going to have a drive-by drop-off from 6 to 7 o'clock in which you can bring and donate a frozen turkey or a couple of frozen turkeys that will be used as part of that giveaway for those those folks who come through at the next food pantry. So if you're able to do that, now again, that's November 16th, November 17th from 6 to 7. Please bring it then. I think Lori told me that Publix starts their turkeys on sale November 15th. So you can time that out perfectly. Yeah, you can go to different stores. All right, we're going to get real creative there. But please do bring them on that drop-off day. We don't have the space to receive them during the week and keep them frozen. So please make note, and if you're able to give, that's a wonderful way to serve. So I want you to be aware of that. Last thing I want to highlight, I want to introduce somebody to you. This morning with us is Corey Weckerly. Let's see, Corey's in the back. Everybody turn around and wave. Say hi, Corey. Corey's one of the organizers for STREAM, which is Manatee County Justice Ministry, that works together. In this last year, they've, together with other churches in our county, have been involved in working for affordable housing, which is a tremendous need in our community, and some pre-arrest intervention measures. So Corey's here. If you are interested in learning a little bit about what STREAM does and being involved, after the service, he's going to be in the gathering place. And then on November 15th at 6:30, which is a Wednesday night, probably in the library, I don't know, I'll announce the room next week, we will have a meeting with Corey for folks to learn a little bit about this ministry and mission and the impact it's having and see what it would mean to be involved. So please take a few moments after worship, say hello to Corey, introduce yourself, learn a little bit about what STREAM's doing, and then we'll have a time with him in more detail in the weeks to come, and I'll announce that again next week. So again, good to have you with us this morning, Corey. Welcome, and welcome to all of you. Let's turn our hearts now to worship. Let's prepare our hearts to celebrate God's presence, and let's open with a word of prayer. Gracious God, thank you for this day. Thank you for these moments we have to be together to experience the community of faith and to be strengthened in our walk with Christ, to be strengthened in our service together, and to lift our voices high in your praise and worship. Bless all that we do now to your glory. We pray in Christ's holy name. Amen.
Solid.
Friends, as we remain standing together now, let's join together this morning in our affirmation of faith, the Apostles' Creed. Let us now confess. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Thank you, friends. Please be seated. And kids, you are now invited to meet your teachers in the back. And I was told that we were a little tight on seats this morning, so if you were looking for a spot, they just opened up. As the kids go back, and we bless them in their time. And this morning, as we turn to these moments of prayer and these moments we create for each of us to lift our hearts to the Lord, this is the first Sunday after All Saints' Day. And in the Apostles' Creed, that third article, I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, which means the universal church in Christ, and the communion of saints, reminds us that we have a bond together in the Holy Spirit, not just within this community of faith where we share our lives of faith and live that out together, but with the church universal, those who worship in all places at all times, and those who have come before us. And we're reminded that not even death separates that bond that we have in the Holy Spirit. And I share that with you because this is a day that we in the church often set aside to remember the saints. And when we talk about the saints, we mean those in Christ. It's another way of talking about the church. We remember the saints that have gone before us. That's why this afternoon the Stephen ministers will host a time to remember, and those of you that have RSVP'd will come and have an opportunity to remember the saints that have gone before. And as we approach prayer, I invite you today to take these moments and moments throughout the day to remember those who have gone before, those that have lived before us a life of faith and have blessed us and whose love has shaped us, those who have come into God's promises and the hope that we have, the assurance that we have that one day we'll be together again. But in these moments of in between that full restoration, we thank God for their lives. We celebrate them. So in these moments, remember, name them. Thank God for them and be inspired by those, that as others have left a legacy in your life, we will live in such a way that we'll leave a legacy of love and faith in the lives of those who come after us. The communion of saints of all time and place, bonded together by the Holy Spirit. So again, as we come to prayer, let me just encourage you, among the other things you may have on your heart today, to name those who you remember today and give God thanks for them. It is the day we remember the saints who have gone before. So with that, friends, let's go to God and pray. Lord, we remember and we give you thanks for the saints who have gone before, who have finished their race, have received their inheritance, who know what it's like for the mortal to put on immortality. We give you thanks for them, for their life that in your love will never end, but for their life that in our hearts will continue to have impact. We name them. We celebrate them, sometimes even with tears, because they have been a blessing to us. And as we name them in our hearts, as we name them in our conversations that will carry us through the rest of this day and the days to come, I pray that they will inspire us as they have blessed us, so shape us that we will bless others. As they have left an impact in our lives, so use our lives to impact those who come after us. The communion of saints with those who are, those who have been, and those who have yet to come, we share the bond of the Holy Spirit. So Lord, use us as you have used those who have gone before us to leave a legacy. Hear our hearts. Listen to our words of gratitude and praise, and fix our eyes on Christ as we join together in these moments of prayer, remembering the example he taught and sharing together in his prayer as we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
The one who saved my life.
we enter into this month of November together, wanting us intentionally to frame our thoughts around gratitude. Frame our thoughts around the opportunities we have every day and the ways that God's Word and God's Holy Spirit calls us to be thankful and to practice that in our lives. So we begin this series today. It'll be a three-week series, and it's called Thanks and Giving. We're going to talk about gratitude as the way it ushers us into a powerful experience of God's presence, but also as a way that it begins to manifest in the way that we live generously in many aspects of our lives. So looking forward to these next weeks together as we, you know, approach that holiday of Thanksgiving, as we spend these times really thinking deeply about the practice of gratitude in each of our lives. And so we're going to start this morning in the Gospel of Luke. We've been in the Gospel of Luke a lot here lately, and we're going to be here again. Chapter 17. And in these few verses, we read an experience, one of the many stories of healing that we find in the Gospels. But it really is, as you will obviously pick up, a story of gratitude. So we begin Luke chapter 17 at verse 11. This is what we read. It says, "Now on his way to Jerusalem, Jesus traveled along the border between Samaria and Galilee. As he was going into a village, 10 men who had leprosy met him. They stood at a distance and called out in a loud voice, 'Jesus, Master, have pity on us.' When he saw them, he said, 'Go show yourselves to the priests.' And they went, and as they went, they were cleansed. One of them, when he saw he was healed, came back, praising God in a loud voice. He threw himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him. He was a Samaritan. Jesus asked, 'Were not all 10 cleansed? Where are the other 9? Has no one returned to give praise to God except this foreigner?' And he said to him, 'Rise and go. Your faith has made you well.'" Brothers and sisters, this is the word of God for the people of God. Let us pray. Lord, give us faith. Like that leper, faith that is lived out in the expressions and the gratitude of our lives. And speak in these moments through your words. Speak in these moments through these words that I speak. They be inspired by your Holy Spirit and make us open and receptive to your truth in our lives. We pray this in Christ's holy name. Amen. So interestingly enough, this is one of the stories that we find in the Gospel of Luke that is only found in the Gospel of Luke. And these verses, especially the middle part of Luke, verses 10 through 19, there's a lot of stories that Luke recounts, experiences of Jesus' life that are unique to that gospel. And this is one of them. And the setup, if you will, for this experience is that Jesus is traveling from Galilee to Jerusalem. We've talked about this, about a 90-mile trip. Galilee in the north, Jerusalem further in the south. And in order to go, remember, Jesus' base of ministry, for much of his ministry, was around Galilee. He was based in Capernaum, which was one of the villages there on the shores of Galilee. And so he's traveling to Jerusalem. So Samaria is along the way. And in this case, he's on the outskirts of Samaria. And that's kind of where this experience comes up, as he encounters these 10 men with leprosy. Now, leprosy is something that we read about with some frequency in the scriptures. It's talked about 68 times in the Bible, 55 times in the Old Testament, 13 times in the New Testament. And it was a illness of the skin that was incredibly painful and debilitating at the least. It was a broad term used to describe a lot of ailments and afflictions of the skin, but it was most often manifest in white spots on the skin, open sores, and even at the most extreme, fingers and toes would fall off. So it was devastating physically. In fact, it's interesting, the earliest description of leprosy in the scriptures is in Numbers 12, the earliest description of somebody who has leprosy. And that was in the account of Miriam, who was Moses' sister, who questions, Miriam and Aaron question Moses, and as a punishment, they're afflicted, or Miriam is afflicted with leprosy. She would shortly thereafter be healed of it. But that's the first description we have of it in the scriptures, and that's about 1500 B.C. Now, I'm not implying that's the first time leprosy ever was experienced, but that's the earliest account we have scripturally. It is today called Hansen's disease. And the reason it's called Hansen's disease is because it was not until 1871 that a doctor by the name, last name of Hansen, discovered the bacteria that caused leprosy. It was not until 1981 that we had a definitive cure for it. Up until 1981, leprosy, or the 20th century, depending on some other treatments, there was no cure. For 3,500 years, and I'm sure more, of human history, there was no cure. Leprosy was deadly. It was deadly. Even today, the World Health Organization tells us there's about 250,000 people in the world afflicted with what we would call Hansen's disease or leprosy, mainly in countries that don't have the availability of the antibiotics that now treat it relatively easily. But I mean, it just gives you a perspective of how physically destructive this illness was. Now, what you also need to understand is how emotionally and relationally devastating leprosy was. Because in addition to the physical ailments, in the time of Jesus, lepers were outcasts from the community. They were unclean. So they had to live in their own communities with other lepers, hence the reason 10 are coming to Jesus in this story. They had to wear clothes that were torn. They had to keep their hair unkept, all as a sign to others that they had this illness and they were untouchables. And then when they would approach people, most often what they had to yell was, "Unclean! Unclean!" so that they could warn others to stay away. I want you to kind of feel the weight of this for a moment. That means their family bonds are broken. That means their relationships within the community are broken. They can have no interaction. They cannot in any way return to the life that they had once known. They are complete and total outcasts from their own community. This is the situation. This is the experience. This is the weight these 10 men would have been carrying when they come to Jesus. And it's why, at the very first verse we read, verse 11, it says, they stood at a distance. Right? They stood at a distance. They dare not come close to Jesus because they didn't want to make him unclean. And they cry out, and here's what's interesting. They cry out, not, "Lord, heal us," but, "Lord, have pity on us." Or some translations, "have mercy on us." They are crying out to the compassion of Jesus. Is it because they didn't want to be healed? No, they absolutely wanted to be healed. But they knew that the healing, that if there was any chance of them being healed, the what would give birth to that healing, what would provoke Jesus to make them well if he was able to do it, would be his compassion, would be his love, would be his caring for them. Because that's the nature of God. And they're hoping, they're praying that this Jesus demonstrates that nature of God. Of course, we know that's exactly who he is. So in Psalm 103, verse 8, when it says, "The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love," that's what they're banking on, that he is compassionate and gracious. And so they come from a place of desperation. Have pity on us. Our lives have been stolen from us because of this illness. Now, that is exactly what moves Jesus. I think that is the characteristic of Jesus. We've been in our young adult group on Sunday nights. We've been reading through the Gospels, first Matthew, and we're finishing up Mark. And so we talk about some of these miracles. And I asked the question a week or so ago. I said, "What do you think moved Jesus to perform miracles?" And we can talk about demonstrating the authority of God. We can demonstrate the power of God, the authority of Jesus. All of those things are important. But here's what we landed on, as the reason Jesus did miracles, the reason Jesus healed people. Because he could. Because he could. And because he cared about people. And he saw people and he loved them. And the scriptures tell us that, and this is a phrase that is easy to gloss over. I think it's easy to kind of move through quickly because it seems just descriptive and kind of standard. But it says that when he saw them. And I think that's really important. Because Jesus saw people. And here's what I mean. We sometimes see people, but we don't see people. We look away, we pretend not to notice. You're driving and you come to the stoplight and the person's moving down asking for money and you just kind of, you know he's there, you know she's there, but you just kind of look the other way. Or you're in the supermarket and you see somebody that you have a broken relationship with, strained, maybe a fallout. You see him at a distance. You see him, but then you pretend not to see him. Because you don't want the awkwardness. You don't want the experience. All of those things I think probably we've all done from time to time. Jesus doesn't. Jesus sees them in their need, in their brokenness, in their hurt. He sees them. And out of his compassion, he moves to bring restoration and healing. But here's what is so fascinating. He does it in a way different than he had in the past. He doesn't approach them. Now, we might look at this and say, well, of course, they had leprosy. He wouldn't approach them. But that's never stopped him before. In Matthew 8 and Luke 5, Jesus heals a man with leprosy. In both places, it tells us that he touched him. Jesus is never worried about touching the unclean. He's never worried that they're going to make him unclean. What he knows is he's going to make them whole. And so it's not that. But he gives them a directive. And he says, go show yourselves to the priests. Go show yourself. He doesn't say you're healed. He doesn't say I've made you whole. I've removed the leprosy. It's all good. He says, go show yourselves to the priests. Now, again, that's a directive that may not make sense to us unless you know the Levitical law, the law of the Old Testament, the Torah. Because in Leviticus chapter 13 and 14, God gives directive to the priests of both how to diagnose somebody with leprosy. That's in Leviticus 13, but then also how to restore somebody to the community who has been healed from leprosy. Here's what's interesting. They probably never had to do that because you didn't get healed from leprosy. There was no cure, except for the places, there are some stories in both the Old and New Testament where there is healing. Aside from the very occasional miraculous healing, nobody got better from leprosy. So it's very safe to assume the priest had never had this kind of an experience. That would have been a whole interesting experience unto itself. But that's why he says go to the priest, because it's the priest who then would give the directions for these one-time lepers to be restored to community. And Jesus just says, go show yourself to the priest. But it doesn't say that he made them well. They had to go on faith. Paul would say we walk by faith and not by sight. Sometimes we have to trust God even when we don't see the evidence that we are looking for. And so he's wanting to see if they're going to trust. Because they're going to the priest before anything has happened. And then very succinctly and very quickly, the very next line, as they went, as they were obedient, as they did what Jesus told them to do, they were cleansed. Stop. They were cleansed. Let that sink in for a moment. Because you can only understand the power of that statement when you understand the depth of isolation and brokenness and ostracism they would have experienced because of their disease. The pain of being separated from family. The hurt of no longer being welcomed in their own community. The longing they would have. Who knows how many years they had prayed for this. No matter how many desperate attempts they had made to find places or people that could cure or heal them and restore them, because all they wanted was their lives back. And in that moment, they look down and their skin is clean. And I don't think many of us, or maybe even any of us, can understand the euphoria, the joy that would have flooded their souls in that moment. They're about to get everything that they had prayed and wished for, the thing that they had longed the most for. They are about to be restored, families reunited, communities reintegrated, by their presence. And into that moment, one leper stops in his tracks. One leper cuts short the journey to restoration, to go back to express gratitude. And it says there in the last couple of verses that we read that as he went, he worshiped God, verse 15, and then when he gets to Jesus, he falls down on his knees and he thanks God. Before he does anything, before he does the things that he had most desired, that had been the most important to him for years and years and years, he goes back and gives thanks. And I want you to hear me say this first. Gratitude brings us into the presence of Jesus. Gratitude brought him back to Jesus, to before he did anything else, to express thanks. And here's the question that this story forces me to ask of myself. And maybe it's the question you need to ask of yourself. Do you thank God as often as you ask God? Because nine did not go back. Nine continued on their journey, though they had gotten the very thing they had most longed for. They knew how to ask. They didn't know how to thank. Or at least they didn't express it. Do you thank God? Do I thank God as much as I ask God? Because the scriptures over and over and over again tell us that we are to be a people of thankful hearts. Psalm 9:1, I will give thanks to you, Lord, with all of my heart. I will tell of your wonderful deeds. Paul writes to the church in Thessalonica, 1 Thessalonians 5:18, give thanks to the God in all circumstance, for this is God's will for you in Jesus Christ. And we could go on and on about places we are called to be people of gratitude, to be people of thanks. Do you thank God as much as you ask God? That's the challenge that we have. Only one. And in doing so, it opened him to receive something the others hadn't. It's a fascinating encounter. And when he comes and Jesus brings him to his feet, he says, after he asks, where were the other nine? He says these words to him, your faith has made you well. Now, faith is the vehicle for his gratitude. It's because of his faith that he comes to express gratitude. He says, your faith, the reason for your gratefulness, has made you well. Now, here's what's so interesting about that statement. It doesn't mean to imply that the healing for the other nine was no longer valid. They were healed. But one was made well. That's different. It's not just a temporary physical healing, but there's a spiritual blessing that he receives. The word well in the Greek there, in that is the root is sozo. And it means to be saved or salvation. It appears over 100 times in the New Testament. Sometimes it applies to physical healing, but most often it applies to the restoration of the soul. It applies to the salvation that God gives. It applies to a wholeness that is given through faith beyond just the physical. So when an angel in Matthew 1 appears to Joseph to announce Mary's pregnancy of the Holy Spirit, he tells Joseph that you will bring forth a son and you will name him Jesus, and he will save his people. Sozo, salvation. In Ephesians 2:8, when Paul writes to the church, he says, for by grace you have been saved through faith. For by grace you have been saved. Sozo. You have been healed. You have been restored. You have received a complete blessing through Christ. That is what he receives. Gratitude opens us up to receive the fullness of God's blessings in our lives because we see it. See, gratitude doesn't make God gracious. It opens our eyes to see how God is gracious. And we have to be intentional about it. One leper. I don't think for a second. I've heard other people write or other pastors do sermons on this, and they've said that the other nine were ungrateful. I don't think they were. I don't think they were ungrateful. They were just so anxious to get on. They were so anxious for the restoration. I mean, they're doing what Jesus told them to do. He said, go show yourself to the priests. I don't think they're ungrateful. But it is so easy for us in our prayers to ask, and when God blesses us in the ways that we're asking, then to move on to the next thing without intentionally taking the moments to be grateful. And when we do, we begin to close ourselves off to the presence of Christ. Gratitude opens us up to the Holy Spirit. And we need to be intentional about practicing gratitude. We need to ask ourselves, how do we build that into the fabric of our lives? And again, I have to do the same because I'm so easily task-driven that I'll just get to the next thing. And so a few weeks ago, and it was independent of my preparation for the sermon, but I saw an outline that a pastor mentor had shared with some people for daily journaling. And I can be hot and cold in my daily journaling. And one of the things it said was start each day by writing down five things you are grateful for. And so I started doing that. And I wrote it in such a way that every day when I go to that day, I see what I listed the previous day. And started naming, just starting my day and my devotions and my prayer time with five things that I'm grateful for. Now here's what's interesting. Life can change very, very quickly. And sometimes the foundation can give way real quick. Thursday morning, I kid you not, this is not like some story that a preacher makes up because it's effective. This is truth. Just seeing if you're listening. I don't do that, but anyway. You're like, what did he say? Now you can be like, every time I tell a story, you can be like, well, is that one of them stories? Thursday morning, I've started a few weeks ago just getting actually a little longer than that. First thing I do in the morning when I get up is I go for a walk, just to kind of get moving, enjoy the morning. It's quiet. The cars aren't out on the roads yet, so I just go for a walk. And so I sat down Thursday, and in my thankfulness, the first thing I put is, I am thankful that I can get up every morning and go for a walk. An hour later, I kid you not, I blew out my back worse than I have ever blown out my back before. I kid you not, for the last 3 days, I've been shuffling. This is the best I've looked in 3 days, at least moving. Forget the physical appearance. I was laid up. I went on Wednesday, because a lot of us have step trackers. I've tracked about 10,000 steps. On Thursday, I tracked 300. Because my day, I was able to move and come in the office, but it was pitiful. I couldn't stand up straight. I was in a lot of pain. It was tough. And so I get there Friday morning, and I look at my thankful list, and the first thing I see is I'm thankful I can walk every morning, and I haven't walked since Thursday morning. And you could say, well, there goes that thankfulness, but no. This is what gratitude does. Gratitude allows us to see God in other ways. And so I could write on Friday, I'm thankful for Advil. You think I'm kidding. I'm thankful for ice packs. I'm thankful for modern medicine. I'm thankful for a wife that will wait on me in my time of need. See, it doesn't change. Certainly I'm not thankful for that, and I'm thankful I'm getting better, but it was not a fun few days. And then I'm still going to have to recover and be smart. No comment. But it didn't change a heart of gratitude. It just redirected it. And all those things are kind of lighthearted, but it's true. You can find in all circumstances. It doesn't mean you're thankful for all circumstances, but we can find reasons to be thankful. And when it does, it ushers us into the presence of Christ in a powerful way. It opens us up to the blessings of God, to sozo, to salvation, to wholeness and restoration. And so my challenge for you is twofold. Again, that question, let it resonate. Do you thank God as much as you ask God? And then what are the ways in your life to build the practice of gratitude? Because it needs to be intentional. It needs to be intentional. But when we do, it ushers us into a presence and a relationship with Christ that brings sozo, the wholeness of salvation and grace. So my invitation, not just in this month, but maybe it just needs to start in this month. Practice gratitude every day. In whatever way you are led, practice gratitude that your faith would make you well. Amen? Let's pray. Gracious Lord, we pray for that to be the truth of our lives, that we would practice gratitude, that we would find ourselves more like the one and less like the nine. Because too often we move to the next thing. We move to the next need or struggle or burden without taking time to be thankful each day for your blessings and your presence, your salvation. Create in us thankful hearts that we may too experience the power of the fullness of Christ's presence and blessings upon us. We pray this in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Now, friends, we prepare our hearts to celebrate communion, and I remind you that we celebrate an open table. So all who desire to share of the sacrament with us are invited to. And so I'm going to ask you now, if you didn't get a communion packet, but you'd like to celebrate communion, all you need to do is raise a hand and keep it up, and our ushers will come and find you. So if you didn't get one, if you'll just raise your hand, we'll see, okay, yep, leave it up. I see one there, and they'll come and bring that to you. And let me invite all of us to open the communion packets to the bread and then to the juice. And let us begin with remembrance. On the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, there in the upper room with his disciples, Jesus took bread and gave thanks to God, and he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples. And he said, "This is my body broken for you." After supper, Jesus took the cup. And again, he gave thanks to God. And he gave it to them. And he said, "This is my blood of a new covenant. It is poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Every time you drink it, do it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these God's mighty acts in Christ Jesus, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as we proclaim the mystery of faith, which says Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Friends, let us pray. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit on us and on these elements, bread and juice, the fruit of the vine, the product of the land, that for us, it would be so much more. That the cup would remind us of the blood that has been shed for our forgiveness, for our salvation, and that we are called by your Holy Spirit to be the body of Christ, united in the communion of saints, to live a life that brings glory to Christ and serves and loves others. So, Lord, find us faithful to that call until one day we enter your kingdom. One day we forever will share this meal at your heavenly banquet. Until that day, Lord, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world as we give to you, through Christ our Lord, all glory and honor. And the people of God said, Amen. Brothers and sisters, this is the body of Christ. It is broken for you. Take and eat. This is the cup of Christ, the blood shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Take and drink. Gracious God, for this sacrament, for the power of your Holy Spirit at work within us, we give you thanks. We give you thanks. In Christ we pray. Amen.
As we sing our last song.
All my words. got nothing new. How could I express all my gratitude? I could sing these songs as I often do, but every song must end. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again, 'cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but I've nothing else fit for a king except for a heart singing.
Not just be the song of our worship together, but it'd be the song of the day-to-day living of our lives, that gratitude, that hallelujah to God. As we close today, I want to share a couple things. One, I'm sure she thought she was getting away from this, but today is Miss Christy McElwain's birthday. So let's say happy birthday to Christy. She shared with me this morning that she has been playing piano, keyboard for this church for 33 years. So, which means she started when she was two. So, So we say happy birthday. I also remind you that Corey Weckerly's with us, and he'll be in the gathering place after worship to talk more with you if you want to know more about the work of Stream and being involved in that. So see Corey. And then lastly, always, our Stephen ministers are here following the worship service. They're here up front. If you need prayer, allow them to have that moment of prayer with you before you leave. And let us go as we begin this journey together, this month of November, with hearts of gratitude, singing our hallelujahs to the Lord each and every day to experience the power of his presence. Go in his peace, his love, in the power of his compassion and mercy, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.